Thank you so much for having me here at Circularity 20. Although I wish circumstances were different and I was welcoming you to my hometown of Atlanta, Georgia, I'm so excited to join you here today to take you on my journey of starting Gooder. I want to take you back to 2013. It was when I had first moved to the city of Atlanta from Phoenix, Arizona. Coming here with a goal to really embark on an entrepreneurship dream of making sure that causes were recognized and that people were doing something good. As I was driving through downtown Atlanta, I saw hundreds of people that were experiencing homelessness. And while I'm often asked, what made you do what I'm about to tell you I started doing, I never have had an answer. All I can tell you is that something pulled on my heartstrings in that moment. And I believed that I could do something to help someone else. I went home that night and I posted on Facebook that next Sunday I was gonna go out and I was gonna start this initiative called Sunday Soul. And the idea was that I would bring a mixture of homemade soulful meals, something like you would enjoy here in the South, and mix it with a good old fashioned R&B soul afternoon. So think Marvin Gaye, Aretha Franklin, Jackson 5, and more. A mixture of music and of food. And I called it Sunday Soul ATL. And that weekend, I went out with about $120 and created my first meal. It was very simple. Spaghetti, garlic bread, corn, and garden salad. And I fed about 150 people that day. And while it was a small gathering, I saw the change that was happening right before my eyes. And I became so filled with passion to do this as much as I could. While I didn't have a lot of money, and I often would piece together $3, $5, and $10 donations, often spending about $350 to feed up to 500 people, I learned to be crafty. I learned to coupon, and I learned to price match. And my Sunday Soul initiative grew leaps and bounds. I started doing this every other week for the period of 3 years. And it was one Sunday when I noticed a man who became a little angry because we were letting women and children go first. And he said to me, I've been waiting in line for over an hour. And I said, sir, I've been cooking for hours. I promise you there's gonna be enough food for everyone. And he said to me, your meals are the ones I look forward to the most. And no one ever comes out here during the week. And so if I don't eat today, I don't know when I'll ever eat again. And that really shook me to my core. And I thought to myself, how often do I sit and wait at a restaurant? If I go to a restaurant and the wait is an hour long, I might find another place to go. But here I am serving people every other week, hundreds and hundreds of people, some waiting in line for 2 to 3 hours. And that didn't sit right with me. So I changed the way that I was doing things. With the goal to always serve people with dignity, I created what was called the Sunday Soul Pop-Up Restaurant. And I started to rent tables and chairs and linens. And I would get flowers donated from Trader Joe's. I would print out these menus. And the idea was to give people a 5-course meal. It would always start with soup, salad, appetizers, an entree with 2 sides, and of course, end with dessert. I wanted people to feel like I felt when I went out to eat, that they were being served, that they were being cared about, and that they had dignity and choice. And it was a video from one of my pop-up restaurants that I held underneath the bridge, right next to the Coca-Cola Center here in Atlanta, that went viral on Facebook, that changed my entire trajectory of my life. As my pop-up restaurant went viral in February of 2016, I woke up one morning to thousands of friend requests, over 2 million views, thousands of shares and comments. As I read through the comments one night, amongst the praise, there was one reoccurring question: who donates the food? And the reality was nobody. I was couponing, I was price matching, I was going to so many different stores. I would start cooking on Friday afternoon, start shopping on Thursday, and actually cook until the wee hours of the morning on Sunday when I would go out and serve. And so I started thinking to myself, how amazing would this be? How amazing could it be if I could get food donated to actually feed these vulnerable populations that I was seeking to serve? And that's what led me to understanding food waste. A simple Google search, what happens to extra food at the end of the night, led me to something that angered me more than very few things have in my lifetime. When I learned that over 72 billion pounds of perfectly good food in this country was going to waste when nearly 42 million people were going to bed hungry, I became upset. I couldn't understand it. We literally had two problems, food waste and hunger, that could virtually solve themselves. And so I thought, this has to be being done. Why isn't this being done already? And so I went out and I started to ask the question. Every restaurant I would go to, I would ask them at the end of the night, what do you guys do with your surplus food? And restaurant after restaurant, grocery store after grocery store, I'm talking about any event venue I went to, this question was asked by me. And every answer was always the same. We throw it away. Oh, we were sued one time, and so we can no longer give the food away, so we have to throw it away. And I would go and I would research and I would try and find lawsuits and try and figure out how was it that someone was being sued for doing something good. And the reality is I could never find them. What I did see was that in 1996, under the direction of President Bill Clinton, the Good Samaritan Act was introduced, actually protecting businesses for donating food in good faith. What I realized is that these businesses weren't educated. And I set about on a path to begin to talk to businesses about the benefits of donating their edible surplus food. And it was a journey that was very lonely. I can't tell you how many people said, oh, this will never work. Businesses will never pay for that. And what I wanted people to understand is that businesses are already paying millions of dollars a year to throw away perfectly good food. Waste is not a new spin on anybody's line item. This is something that every business is paying for, but how can we get businesses to think about what is going into landfills differently? And I set about on that course, lonely, believing that it would happen. If anything kept me motivated, I knew that, if nothing else, by doing this work every single day, someone who would otherwise go hungry would have food. This started to my journey of starting Gooder, which I founded in Atlanta, Georgia in 2017. With nothing but a clickable prototype that was built at Georgia Tech, I started to enter pitch competitions. And I would speak of the fact that millions of pounds of perfectly good food was going to waste every single night, with businesses spending over $218 billion a year on food that we never eat, while at the same time, millions of people would go to bed hungry that very night. And that families were having to make critical decisions, often choosing between paying for bills like their rent and their utilities and paying for food. I believed wholeheartedly that no one should ever have to decide if food was a necessity in their household. And the reality is it was happening far too much. And so throughout 2017, I raised enough money to actually launch Gooder, build that first version of the mobile app and the portal, get some of my first clients, and start to do the work. And while I didn't have technology when I started, I had the process. Businesses would text me when they had excess food. I would go pick it up. I would deliver it to a nonprofit. I would take a picture. I would get a donation receipt. I would then categorize everything that was donated and send it back to that client. And so I had built out the process before I ever built the technology. And most importantly, I was feeding people. Flash forward till today, Gooder is not only just in Atlanta, Georgia, we're servicing multiple markets. We're launching this week in New Jersey and Philadelphia. We're bringing on amazing customers like Merck, Netflix, the world's busiest airport, Atlanta, Hartsfield, Atlanta, Jackson, the Atlanta Hawks, and many more. And what we've begun to help people understand is that food is a precious resource, and that it doesn't need to be in landfills. No business can ever be truly sustainable until they start to understand what's happening with the food waste at their business. And I would have customers say to me, oh, well, we're a tech company. We're not in the food business. And I would say to them, well, you have 100,000 employees across 20 different campuses, and you serve food every day. You're in the food business. And so while that's something that I still have to teach a lot of people, it's a message that I'm still trying to get to resonate. What I can tell you, now having helped divert nearly 5 million pounds of edible surplus food from landfills, a huge increase that we've seen since March through our COVID-19 response, we've gotten so much food to families that I hope that everyone can understand that if we want to create a true circular economy, we cannot leave food waste out of the picture, and that we have a huge opportunity in front of us to make sure that our neighbors do not go hungry, that our environment does not suffer, by making sure that the businesses that we frequent, that the places that we work at, do not waste food. So I wanna invite everyone to join me on this journey. You can learn more about us by visiting gooder.co. Please bring us to your city. I'm looking forward to working with everyone who's attending Circularity 20 this year. I wanna thank you guys so much for having me and let you all know that with Gooder, hunger and food waste have met their match. Thank you and have a great day.